Welcome to the Tackling Tech Podcast, powered by Dyknow. Join us as we tackle all things EdTech with insightful interviews, actionable tips, and strategies that you can implement in your school or district to make technology integration more effective. Whether you're a teacher, a tech coach, or a technology administrator, we're giving you an advantage in your role by sharing stories from people who are passionate about working with their peers and enhancing the learning experience with technology. Thanks for spending some time with us today. Now let's tackle some tech.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Tackling Tech, a podcast that shares stories on how you can build better collaboration in K-12 schools and a show that is dedicated to putting a voice to remote learning. I am Brett McGrath, Vice President of Marketing at Dyknow, and I'm really excited for another compilation episode here on remote learning. I know this is a very, very difficult and challenging time for K-12 education. You've got school calendar years getting pushed back. You've got uncertainty whether you're going back to school in the physical classroom, or is it going to be remote learning or distance learning again, or is it going to be a hybrid? There's a lot of questions that still need to be answered. And our hope with these episodes is that we can share voices that we've been talking with on a regular basis on Tackling Tech that have insights on distance or remote learning and their experiences. We're really fortunate that once remote learning started in March, we started talking to educators, and really the goal of talking with the educators was to get an understanding of the good, bad, and the ugly, what sort of things were working, what wasn't, and we pulled some great stories from all of those conversations. So that's what we're going to do today. We are going to do volume two. Hopefully you enjoyed volume one of remote learning. If you haven't heard that, definitely go back. And on this episode, we're going to have people like Erica Rodriguez, who's a teacher, and she's going to be talking about challenges with their LMS during remote learning. We're going to talk with Rochelle Danae Poth, and she's going to talk about challenges of trying to maintain connections with students during remote learning. Pearl Arredondo, who was a keynote speaker at one of our digital events, is going to talk about the challenge of keeping students engaged during remote learning. You have Josh Bridges, who will discuss how he's been multitasking, and the list goes on and on and on and on, from, you know, Liz Wallhoff to Sean Coffrin to Jake Miller to Eric Geist to Chris Woods. Man, that Chris Woods episode, still I think my favorite. I can't believe he built his own house. That's just an amazing story, and he loves STEM. It's great stuff. I love that. But anyways, I think this episode should give you some ideas on things that people like you have dealt with during remote learning, and identify ways that you can make some improvements going into this year. Always follow Tackling Tech on Twitter at Tackling Tech Pod. Definitely hit the subscribe button and leave us that 5-star reviews if you're liking it. We've got so much content going on right now on the Dyknow front. I was out a week and just so amazed by what our team is doing right now. We're posting new blog posts every day on dyknow.com. We are in the process of planning for our next digital event. There's so much, and we're just trying to be a resource for you as you get going back to school this year. So hope you enjoyed this episode. If you have any feedback on it, definitely reach out. We'd love to have that conversation. Enjoy. Have you had any challenges just in terms of technology and its availability to, you know, all of the students that you're currently teaching?
I actually have. Our LMS was bogged down. And so this week was really our big push. And a lot of the kids said, I can't get on. I have two high school kids and an elementary kid myself. And the high school kids are like, Mom, I can't get on the internet. And I said, just put it down and try it again. Later, one of my daughters even said, I'm going to become a vampire and I'm going to sleep during the day and get on at night because that's when nobody else is on. I was like, that's a smart idea, but I'm going to have to squash that right away. So the internet connectivity has been one of the big, big downfalls right now, because I know our LMS has sent out information that said that their usage has jumped 400%. That's huge. Yeah. So that's our biggest drawback. But we're pretty lucky because our secondary level is all one-to-one. So our kids have computers already that they take home with them. So we were really lucky on that point because there are other districts that are not one-to-one.
What are your biggest observations that you've made as a teacher since, you know, you've been operating remotely?
The number one thing is the need and, you know, the importance of always making sure that we can have a decent or, I mean, as good as we can, an understanding of our students and their families and what their access is at home, and focusing first and foremost on making those connections, whether we're in our classroom, just regular school, or if we have something like this happen again in the future. And that is something that, you know, initially, like, you don't plan for this, right? You might be using a messaging app or have emails or, of course, phone calls and things like that, or your school website, but you never truly know if the messages that you're sending are being received. But when you have students coming into your classroom, like, even if they didn't get the message that you sent, for example, like, you can still have a follow-up conversation. And so sometimes whether or not they actually got that message or were able to access something that you sent, you don't necessarily know. And so I think that that is something that really I've started to focus on more, and I'm noticing has been a common theme for, you know, a lot of people is finding a way to keep those connections and that collaboration going.
I'm curious how it's gone at your school and if you've picked up any good learnings that you can share with the audience.
Yeah, it definitely was quite the transition. We had a matter of, I think, days to flip our school from brick and mortar to completely online. And I think what really helped is that we were already pretty immersed in technology. Our students were really comfortable using our learning management system of Schoology, and so were our teachers. So the learning curve wasn't as high as I think other schools may have experienced, but our teachers definitely needed to learn how to use Zoom and all the ins and outs of breakout sessions and also, you know, how do you put lessons together so that they're virtual? And then how do you connect with students? And I think that's been our hardest piece, is that student engagement, because our families have a lot of different circumstances. We can't just say, oh, you have to be on this Zoom meeting at 9, another one at 12, another one at 2, and these assignments are due at the end of the day. Like, it doesn't work like that with our families. So we've been trying to be structured yet flexible so that students can find what they need to do. They can engage when they can. Teachers have been recording Zoom meetings, doing a lot of just short little clips of instructions or what the assignments are, clarifications. They post them. We started our own YouTube channel to get some more like just informational videos out there, some fun ones too, just to kind of engage students. So it's been quite the learning experience for us, definitely.
So how has all of those roles, how have you been balancing that all out during this time?
Not sure that I have. It's been a roller coaster. Right before we got on the call here, I've got an 8-year-old and a 12-year-old. One of them, the 12-year-old, she's in her class meeting, and 8-year-old, I had to make sure he's set up in his class meeting. And then our 2-year-old's begging for daddy to play for a few minutes. And, you know, it's one of those, like, trying to balance everything, trying to make sure that you have your work time every day. You know, like, every day I'm doing office hours, so my kids know from a certain time to a certain time, like, I'm not available. I have to be ready for people to ask questions. And so I've got that. I also manage our student information system. And so we've had a lot of things come down with that, with calendars, and our high school and middle school are trying to get schedules put together for next year. So we're doing that. So it's kind of just like allotting certain amounts of time for different tasks. I've set up where, like, over the weekend, I don't do anything for the last couple of weekends because it's been so hectic. And, you know, if I've got time during the day that I am dedicating to work, and then in the evening, if my kids are all playing, if they're busy, you know, whatever, I might take a little bit of time, check emails, make sure that I'm not falling behind, and try to catch up on some stuff if possible.
How are you, and how is your school and district doing?
I'm doing well. I think, like many people, I'm adjusting to the change. I'm finding that e-learning involves kind of long hours and a different workload than before, a different set of responsibilities than before, but it's good. I think in the long run, we're going to end up having learned a lot more about different ways to learn. And so some of the changes for our district, I'm in a relatively small district right now. We have about 29,000 kids. And so we are, each of our schools, we're a site-based district. So each of our schools is tackling this a little bit differently. At the high school where I work, we put out a pretty simple list for educators on what their responsibilities are. We do share a common LMS, so everybody's in the same place for their digital work, which is super helpful. And we've asked that teachers post one assignment every day, hold an hour of office hours every day, and that they stay on top of their grading and responding back. So that part, I think, is going pretty well. We're checking in with kids each day. I run the school's Instagram account, the main Instagram account that we have. And so I'm on with students every day, back and forth on, you know, how did it go today? What do we need to know? How's it looking from your end? And then we likewise have a discussion board within our LMS for staff on what are celebrations and discoveries that you've had. So right now, I think the biggest thing that's helping our school get through is that we are in a constant process of discovery and learning about how is this shift working? What is the latest and greatest? Where do we need to make adjustments?
You made mention that not a lot has changed over, you know, the first couple weeks, but has there anything in particular to your workflow changed based on your learnings of operating remotely?
Right. Well, I think one of the big differences in the way it's manifested itself is the use of time. I think this is very similar to any other situations when you enter a telework scenario. Things are done a lot more efficiently. There's a lot less water cooler talk, so to speak. And of course, a school is not immune to that. But I think another major thing that's been different is the conversations we're having. It's interesting that classroom management is not necessarily, I mean, of course, classroom management wouldn't be such an issue, but it's interesting that it hasn't really changed the relationship between the student and the teacher. So we're no longer talking about classroom management, but teachers who have reached out to me and talked to me are still very interested in making sure that they're pursuing strong academic relationships with their students and also finding ways for students to collaborate with one another. The change, of course, has been how do we replicate that social aspect of the classroom in an environment where everyone is in front of a screen. And so we talked a little bit about developing breakout rooms and developing activities that promote that either asynchronous discussions through a chat client or synchronous discussions in a video chat. So my workflow in terms of changing has become, rather than focusing on coaching side by side or co-teaching with the instructor in the classroom, preparing them to be able to do that on their own. Whether we end up implementing something like that is yet to be seen, but I'm very excited about the opportunity to be a part of preparing teachers for that so that if the time comes for us to have some sort of a virtual classroom setting, they feel well prepared and they have multiple options so they can differentiate for their students that may have special needs or students who are learning English as a second language.
What is your overall philosophy on just the relationships with teachers and technology, because I know that might have changed or shifted a little bit coming off the heels of this era of remote learning.
Yeah, I don't think it's changed in remote learning. I think what's changed is how easily it is to recognize the relevance of the way I look at educational technology. So I used to look at it in an old position I was at an old school district where I taught. I was part of a district technology leadership team. And we as a team set forth these like baseline technology skills that all of our staff had to be able to do. Like they had to be able to do this on this tool and this on that tool. They had to be able to organize their Google Drive and type in a Google Doc and whatever else we put on that list. And that was my rationale then. And I've really have changed through this time of working with educators to realize that what educators should do is see that educational technology is just a tool that is there for us to help solve problems or meet goals or address learning standards in our classroom. So the best thing we could do in regards to technology is think about what is it that I'm trying to achieve for my students, or what is it I'm trying to do as a teacher, or what is it I'm trying to improve in my practice, or where are some gaps I'm noticing in my students' understanding, and identifying those needs first and then going, okay, where can the technology help me with that?
How are you getting through it and making this normal for you at this point?
I really miss getting to shake the kids' hands or high five or a fist bump, or every morning or every class period I would do that. And I can't do that anymore. So one of the things I always started my class with was a classcraft random event. And we do really odd things with that. And so I wanted to keep that going. So every morning at about 8 o'clock, I get up at around seven or so now, 8 o'clock, I'm on my Screencastify with my Classify and with my Classcraft. And I do a random event virtually with the kids. And then that goes out to the kids through my LMS and we post it. And then they get their point. One of them was like helping hands, and they had to help one of their parents or guardian with a chore. And then if their guardian or parent emailed me back that said that they helped, then they got the XP. So that's one of the ways that I've kind of kept somewhat normal. It's different. I'm spending a lot more time on my computer than I have ever done as a teacher. It's different.
Our district has done a real nice job at kind of planning for a situation somewhat like this. I think we initially planned for a blizzard to happen or a long closing because of snow days or a tropical storm or something like that that comes up, because we had Katrina a couple years ago. Basically, we had staff plan for 2 virtual days a couple years ago because we were getting 5 or 6 snow days and they were pushing our graduation date back until almost July. So our staff had a little bit of a opportunity to play around with this remote learning just through that. And I would say to districts out there that are going to try to be more prepared for situations like this in the future, to maybe start there. If you have snow day opportunities, I know not everyone gets snow, but maybe it's a tropical storm that you get, or, you know, whatever the case may be, I would have your staff develop 2 or 3 virtual days just to be ready for it. And for some, that's working offline. They get a slip of paper or an email that they always have in their email, or a slip of paper that gives them, you know, some stuff that they could do while out without the internet, if they don't have internet capability. And they just keep a hold of it until that time comes. And if it doesn't come, you always have those 2 lessons in the bank. So I would definitely start that way. As far as my role, the workflow of it is really, I just answer questions until about 1:30. And then after that, we do some virtual professional developments. And really, we're just keeping these professional developments pretty simple.
Well, I had already done things like create videos for my students. So let me just first speak to that. My students already knew that I knew how to use technology. So they already knew that I had a YouTube channel, that I had video lessons for all of my algebra class. So for them, it wasn't a big jump to learn something from me on a YouTube video. Now, a couple of things that I've always learned that make those videos better. Number one, if you can have yourself in that video, that's great, because especially now those kids need to see us help some semblance of continuity for them. So actually my videos are me standing in front of the board explaining a problem, just like they would have if they were in my classroom right now. But they're not, because they're remote learning. But number two, I try to keep those videos very short. So mine are anywhere from 45 seconds to like 2 minutes for some really complicated example problems. And basically each video is like one problem or one example. We know kids have a short attention span. And if we're creating videos for our kids, especially in remote learning right now, and you're talking and talking and talking and talking, they're not going to watch that long of a video. They don't watch that long of any video. So that's just a couple of really big key advice if you're making videos for your kids.
So I would say one big thing that I've been seeing when I've been talking with folks is that, you know, they are leveraging some of the best practices and the things that they had in place that were really working well and foundations that they've built in the past. So if they were using Google Classroom or Schoology or an LMS, even on a very surface level in the past, now they're leaning into that a little bit more and looking at how they can use that to go deeper into their connections with students and their connections with families. And then I've also been talking with folks who might not have had a digital space already established. So they're either trying to pull that in as something new, or they are taking a step back and saying, this is something that might overwhelm our school community and our educators that we work with. It might not be the right time to pull in something brand new. And instead, they're shifting their energy to supporting families with recommendations of resources by curating content into collections that families can pick and choose from. If they are able to connect to the internet, right, they might log in and go into the YouTube playlist someone made, or the schools that have provided devices and provided hotspots, right, might lean into some of the foundations they've already established with an LMS, right, with certain expectations for navigating digital spaces and hosting content there. I think everyone, it has the best intentions when sharing work and resources with students and families, but there's a lot of things to take into consideration when it comes to what families have to tackle at home, whether they have family members that are essential workers and then that child is babysitting the other kids in their house during the day, or they might have to move to a new place if their family is dealing with some economic hardship. So I think there's a lot of issues that people are thinking about. But I would say two big trends in my conversation, right, is that idea of leaning in and building off of foundations that are already established when it comes to the use of technology that's felt good in the past, and then making recommendations for families as opposed to setting, you know, hard expectations that might not be realistic or really fair to put out into another community.
What sort of advice might you have for anyone that's currently going through these transitions to, you know, e-learning or remote learning, like one nugget or advice that maybe you didn't touch on in the rest of your responses? Because I think if you're listening, a lot of what was described here can apply to that remote learning environment, but any parting thoughts you might have would be awesome.
Yeah, boy, I've sure been pondering that very intently in this last week, because unlike a lot of other districts who were on spring break this week, we're still in session. So we were e-learning all this week. We'll have spring break next week, and then we'll be back to e-learning for at least another 3 weeks after that. And so, yeah, that's really been on my mind about how do we help folks transition and transition well. And so I think some of the same things apply that we talked about earlier, and then maybe just a couple of new ones. I think in brief, figuring out who your support team is, and that may be people who have had that official designation, and maybe new leaders are going to crop up. You know, I had kids on Instagram yesterday saying, hey, it would really help if we did this thing, and we'll send you a screencast and show you how to do it. So you have your formal support team, and then you have your newly established support team that grows out of this time. I think keep that team tight, focused, and prioritize your work together so that no one person is getting burned out. And then I think the connected to that being talk to your people every day. Not everybody is going to respond, and that's fine. Don't expect that. But talk to your students, talk to your peers, talk to your leadership every day, and just share the reality of what's going on, because people can't support if they don't know what the needs are. So I would say be clear on that. And then the last thing that I would mention, sorry, I went a little over one there, but the last thing I would mention is determine what your new life balance is going to be. For example, I have found that I was glued to my workspace from 6 a.m. till 11 p.m. in the first few days. And I wasn't eating meals, you know, appropriately and so on, because I wanted to be so responsive to people because I know that's what they need right now. But if I make myself sick and I'm out of commission for days or weeks, I'm going to be no use to anybody. So figure out when you can love on your kids, when you can walk your dogs, you know, maybe make prepare your lunch at the time that you make your breakfast and be able to steal that and just grab it as you go. So think of ways to take care of yourself and then establish those, you know, make those boundaries clear to your learners or the people that you're helping as well. These are the times I'm going to be immediately available. And then I'm going to hand off that baton to somebody else so that you can still get help right away. But I need a break sometimes too.
What advice do you have for anybody that's in a similar role to you going into next year post COVID?
I would say first and foremost, keep building relationships. People won't learn from you if they don't like you. And that's so true. And I would also suggest working on wellness. This is an area that I really struggle in, but just really trying to unplug and get away from the computer and focus on yourself. Because if you're not focused on yourself, it's going to be very difficult going back next year. And you just sometimes have to say, no, I need a break.
Yeah, I mean, when anything challenging presents itself, you know, I always hope that everyone can be reflective, right? And that goes for any challenge that you have in your life. You know, I'm always thinking to myself, if something doesn't go the way I had hoped or planned, right, what can I learn from this? And many people, right, that's not just me, right? Many people feel the same way when they're reflecting on situations that felt hard or didn't go what they, you know, the way they thought, or where they had to react really quickly, which is very much the case here. So I hope that folks are feeling already that they can be reflective and saying, we're doing this now, but this is not the best case scenario. And then a month from now, they can say, this is what I'm learning. And then 2 or 3 months from now, they can say, this is what I learned. Mm-hmm. So I'm encouraging folks, and I did a webinar, I think it was last week, where I talked about some distance learning reflections. And one big thing that I was sharing was taking the time to just note take and journal at the end of the day. And this does not have to be a how I'm feeling personal type of journal, although there's benefit in all types of journaling, of course. This is more about the logistical, what worked, what didn't work, what felt hard, what was an obstacle I overcame today, and how did I fix that problem, or what am I still struggling with, or what is something I never want to do again, or that I wish we had done. And so if you're able to jot down a few things at the end of the day, or if you're able to jot down a few things during lunch, you know, Tuesday and Thursday each week, there's going to be immense value in that when we are planning moving forward, because things are moving so quickly, right? People are in situations where they have to adapt very quickly to things that are changing. So if you have an opportunity to jot down a couple things and then pull those into meetings that you have over the summer into the fall, where you can be more thoughtful about initiatives that you want to strengthen moving forward, I think there's a lot of benefit there to doing what I would call just kind of a brain dump at the end of the day, and then sorting through that when you do have the emotional space and the time space to be more reflective. Because there are states already, right, there are school districts that are building in e-learning days into their calendar, who are saying this is not something that is going away, maybe 100% of the time it'll go away, but, you know, or I should say, it won't take up 100% of the time, but maybe we do have to be closed in rolling weeks, you know, in the next school year. Maybe we do have to be shut down for the month of December. I don't think it's crazy to think that that is a possibility, right? Hopefully it's not the case. But if you're going into the new school year without any type of preparation for being closed for the months of November and December, right, when there may be an uptick in our current public health crisis, I think it's super irresponsible, right, to not acknowledge that those are concerns that might happen and we should be prepared for them. It's okay that we weren't prepared for this right now, but it's not going to be okay if we don't have a plan into the next school year. So as much as we can be reflective and data gathering mode right now, I think it'll end up paying off in the long run.
I hope you enjoyed that one. I learned a ton by listening back to it. Hopefully you did too. If you like what you heard, hit the subscribe button, leave that 5-star review. Stay safe, take care of yourself, take care of your house, and we'll talk to you again real soon.